She Saraswati, Nidhe Gaudha Premanandi. All glories to some devotees. All glories to some devotees. All glories to some devotees. All glories to Glossy Shiguru, Shiguranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 So continue our reading from the Shrimad Bhagavatam, reading Canto 10, Chapter 58, which is entitled Krishna Marries Five Princesses. And today we're reading quite a few verses. We're reading from text 23 to text 58, which completes the chapter. So get yourselves attuned for some hearing. A few verses, there's some small purports on the way, and the verse on the board is the last verse. So we'll see how time goes. We repeat together, or if not, we'll just read. So, anyway, so beginning text 23. Ready? Okay, I read the Sanskrit as best I can. If I start to struggle with it, then I stop reading it. But it's nice to hear the Sanskrit. I think it's good. It's good practice as well. Tatava dat kudakeshu vasudevaya sapo sopitam bratam arapya tadvidvan dharajam upagamat. Sukadeva Goswami continued. Arjuna repeated all this to Lord Vasudeva, who was already aware of it. The Lord then took Kalindi onto his chariot and went back to see King Yudhisthira. Yadiva Krishna Sandishta Patanam Paramatbhutam Karayam Ashanagaram Vititram Vishvakamana. Describing a previous incident, Sukadeva Goswami said, upon the request of the Pandavas, Lord Krishna had the Vishvakarma build them a most wonderful, amazing city. Purple. Srila Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur mentions that this city was constructed before the burning of the Kandava forest and hence before the Lord found his bride Kalindi. Bhagavam Statra Nevashan Swanam Priyat Kikshayaha Agnaya Kandavam Dadum Ajonasyasya Sharati. The Supreme Lord stayed in that city for some time to please his devotees. On one occasion, Sri Krishna wanted to give the Kandava forest as a gift to Agni, and so the Lord became Arjuna's charioteer. Purple. Srila Jiva Goswami explains the sequence of events that occurred during Lord Krishna's stay with the Pandavas. He states that first the Kandava forest was burned, then Kalindi was found, then the city was constructed, and then the assembly hall was presented to the Pandavas. Saknis tustodana adad dayan suetan vratam dipa ajunasya kasotono vama chabedyam astribi. Being pleased, O King, Lord Agni presented Arjuna with a bow, a set of white horses, a chariot, a pair of inexhaustible quivers, and armor that no fighter could pierce with weapons. Manyascha mochito vedne sabam sakya upaharat yasmindu do yodanasyachit jalashtala trishi brahma. When the demon Maya was saved from the fire by his friend Arjuna, Maya presented him with an assembly hall, in which Duryodhan would later mistake water for a solid floor. I'll just comment on that little pastime there. This is Duryodhan at this point. This is after the Rajasuya sacrifice. So Duryodhan at this point is burning with envy at the glory and the grandeur and the wealth that the Pandavas have. So out of curiosity as well, he goes to this assembly hall, which Maya Dhanava had created. And he was hiding, being impressed by the hall. Very much so. He was trying to hide that he was trying to make out that the hall was nothing actually. He was walking through the hall. And it was made in such a way that in the center of the hall itself was magnificent, and in the center was a great crystalline pool of water. Crystal, it was perfectly still. And it was made in such a way that it was difficult to actually, unless you were a resident of the palace, there was a good chance you would mistake the floor to be water or the water to be marble. So what happened is he stepped on the piece of the floor which was actually water, and he fell into the water. And up in a balcony above were the Pandavas along with their wife, and they all was laughing heartedly, including the Pandava's wife, Draupadi, isn't it? Yeah, describe it, just read it. All the Pandavas were laughing, including her. And that very much, and because he was very much trying to win her hand, he was very much enamored by her beauty. And he tried to win her hand before in the, what's it called, in the Swayamvara. So he was, and then he was laughing. Yudhisthira told them to control themselves, the brothers, and Krishna was just smiling. Because Krishna is the supreme, he's the supreme conductor of this whole affair. So the whole idea is that the battle of Kurukshetra has to take place. So it's going to take place fueled by the envy of Duryodhan. So Krishna, very tactfully, he was just smiling and wasn't stopping them laughing. In this way, Duryodhan was very much insulted. And then he did the same thing a few times. Then he understood that it was water, not a solid floor. Yeah, and then he walked into a door which wasn't a door. And then another time as well, then in the same time he thought he had observed it was actually not a door. And he went in another direction and then walked into a wall. So in this way you get the picture. Duryodhan was very insulted. And Yudhisthira, actually after he fell in the lake, then Yudhisthira bought him some dry clothes, you know, to wear. And you can read that in Mahabharata. So we continue. Text 28. Satena samanjak satena samanhnata shudribhishchanumodita ayayodavar kambuya sakyaki pramukhai vrita. Then Lord Krishna gave leave to Arjuna and other well-wishing relatives and friends, returned to Dwarka with Satyaki and the rest of his entourage. Text 29. Atopayema kalindim saponya ritvaraksh uchite vitamvan paramanandam svanam paramam mangala. The supremely auspicious Lord Krishna married Kalindi on the day when the season, the lunar asterism and the configurations of the sun and other heavenly bodies were well propitious. In this way he brought the greatest pleasure to his devotees. Vinyano vindayo havanyo doyo doyo vishano Vishanago Swayambare Swabhaginim Krishna Saktam Niyeshtatam. Vindhya and Anuvindhya, who shared the throne of Avanti, were followers of Duryodhana's. When a time came for their sister Mitravinda to select her husband in his Swayambara ceremony, they forbid her to choose Krishna, although she was attracted to him. Purple. The feelings of enmity between the Kuru's and the Pandavas were so strong that Mitravinda's brothers, out of friendship for Duryodhana, forbade the young maiden to accept Krishna as her husband. Rajidevyasthanayam Mitravindam Pitvishvaso Prashaya Hrittavan Krishna Rajan Rajnam Prabhasyatam. My dear king, Lord Krishna forcibly took away Princess Mitravinda, the daughter of his aunt Rajidevi, before the eyes of the rival kings. Nakna jinnama kausalya asit rajati damikaha tasya satya bhavat kanya devi nakna jiti nipra. O king, Nagnajit, the very pious king of Kausala, had a lovely daughter named Satya or Nagnajiti. Natam seko nipavodam ajitva saptako vrisham tikshna sringam sudodasham veya ganda sahankalam. The kings who came as suitors were not allowed to marry her unless they could subdue seven sharp horned bulls. These bulls were extremely vicious and uncontrollable, and they could not tolerate even the smell of warriors. Tamshutva Vishchili Labhyam Bhagavan Satvatam Pati Tagama Kausalaya Puryam Senyena Mahatvritaha. When the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Master of the Vaishnavas, heard of the princess who was to be won by the conqueror of the bulls, he went to the capital of Kausalya with a large army. Sakosala pati prita pratyodano sanadibir ahane pago karuna pojayan patinandita. The king of Kausala, pleased to see Lord Krishna, worshipped him by rising from his throne and offering him a seat of honor and substantial gifts. Lord Krishna also greeted the king respectfully. Varam vilokarya primatam. Let's just read the translation. When the king's daughter saw that most agreeable suitor arrive, she immediately desired to have him, the lord of goddess Rama. She prayed, "May he become my husband, and if I have kept my vows, may the sacred fire bring about the fulfillment of my hopes." So I'll just read the English from now on. Quicker as well. Goddess, this is text 37. Goddess Lakshmi, Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, and the rulers of the various planets placed the dust of his lotus feet on their heads, and to protect the cause of religion which he has created, he assumes pastime incarnations at various times. How may that Supreme Personality of Godhead become pleased with me? King Nagnajit first worshipped the Lord properly and then addressed him. O Narayan, Lord of the universe, you are full in your own spiritual pleasure. Therefore, what can this insignificant person do for you? Text 39. Sukadeva Goswami said, O beloved descendant of the Guru, the Supreme Lord was pleased, and after accepting a comfortable seat, he smiled and addressed the king in a voice as deep as the rumbling of a cloud. 40. The Supreme Lord said, O ruler of men, learned authorities condemn begging for a person in the royal order who is executing his religious duties. Even so, desiring your friendship, I ask you for your daughter, though we offer no gifts in exchange. 41. The king said, My lord, who could be a better husband for my daughter than you, the exclusive abode of all transcendental qualities? On your body, the goddess of fortune herself resides, never leaving you for any reason. 42. But to ascertain the proper husband for my daughter, O chief of the sattvatas, we previously set a condition to test the prowess of her suitors. But according to Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti, the king's actual purpose in setting up was to obtain Sri Krishna as his son-in-law, since only he could subdue the bulls. Without such a test, it would have been difficult for Natnajit to refuse the many apparently qualified princes and kings who came to ask for his daughter's hand in marriage. 43. These seven wild bulls are impossible to tame, O hero. They have defeated many princes, breaking their limbs. 44. If you can subdue them, O descendant of Yadu, you will certainly be the appropriate bridegroom for my daughter, O Lord of Sri. 45. Upon hearing these terms, the Lord tightened his clothing, expanded himself into seven forms, and easily subdued the bulls. Purple. According to Srila Shuddha Swami, Lord Krishna expanded himself into seven forms, not only to playfully defeat the seven bulls, but also to show Princess Satya that she would not have to compete with the other queens, since he could enjoy with all of them simultaneously. 46. Lord Sori tied up the bulls, whose pride and strength were now broken, and pulled them with ropes, just as a child playfully pulls wooden toy balls. 47. Then King Natnajit, pleased and astonished, presented his daughter to Lord Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, accepted this suitable bride in the proper Vedic fashion. Purple. The word Satrisim indicates that the lovely princess was a fitting bride for the Lord, because she possessed wonderful transcendental qualities that complemented his. As Srila Jiva Goswami points out, the word Vishmitaha indicates that King Natnajit was certainly astonished at the many extraordinary events suddenly taking place in his life. Text 48. The king's wives felt the greatest ecstasy upon attaining Lord Krishna as the dear husband of the royal princess, and a mood of great festivity arose. 49. Conch shells, horns, and drums resounded, along with vocal and instrumental music, and the sounds of the brahmanas invoking blessings. The joyful men and women adorn themselves with fine clothing and garlands. Text 50 and 51. As the dowry, powerful King Natnajit gave 10,000 cows, 3,000 young maidservants wearing golden ornaments on their necks and bedecked in fine clothing, 9,000 elephants, 100 times as many chariots as elephants, 100 times as many horses as chariots, and 100 times as many maidservants as many manservants as horses. Okay, that's quite a big dowry. This goes to prove that it's kind of generally the idea presented or put forward is that we are making progress, and in the past it was like uncivilized. like cavemen, but in actuality it's actually the opposite. In the past we were more greatly civilized than we are now, and because everyone generally more or less that was following Dharma, then everything was provided in abundance, and there was great opulence, there was great natural resources and a great wealth. And also in the previous age, Dwarka, it was very Dwapa, then it was characterized by very powerful large families, very powerful dynasties, and they had much and unlimited amounts of wealth, as you can see here. This is not an exaggeration. This is not just a poetic exaggeration. This is an actual fact. This was the size of the dowry. You can probably do your maths and try and work out, but inconceivable to us today. So we are living in the Stone Age today. We are living in the Iron Age. Text 52. The king of Kosala, his heart melting with affection, had the bride and groom seated on their chariot, and then he sent them on their way surrounded by a great army. Text 53. When the intolerant kings who had been rival suitors heard what had happened, they tried to stop Lord Krishna on the road as he took his bride home. But just as the boars had broken the king's strength before, the Yadu warriors broke it now. 54. Arjuna, wielder of the Gandiva bow, was always eager to please his friend Krishna, and thus he drove back those opponents who were shooting torrents of arrows at the Lord. He did this just as a lion drives away insignificant animals. 55. Lord Devaki Suta, the chief of the Yadus, then took his dowry and satya to Dwarka and continued to live there happily. 56. Bhadra was a princess of the Kayikeya kingdom and a daughter of Lord Krishna's paternal uncle Shrutakirti. The Lord married Bhadra when her brothers, headed by Santadana, offered her to him. 57. Then the Lord married Lakshmana, the daughter of the king of Mathura. Krishna appeared alone at her Swayamvara ceremony and took her away, just as Garuda once stole the demigod's nectar. And finally, I'll just read the verse. Text 58. Anyaschevam vidabhaya krishnasya sansahasrasaha omam hadvatam nirodat aritascharudasanaha. Lord Krishna also acquired thousands of other wives equal to these when he killed Bulbasaur and freed the beautiful maidens the demon was holding captive. Thus end the purpose of the humble servants of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, to the 10th canto, 58th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled Krishna Marries Five Princesses. Om Gyanata Varandasya Gananjana Salakaya Chakshum Blitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Taya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shiva Sai Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutaya Shanta Bhakti Vedanta Swamti Namane Namaste Sarasati Devi Gauravani Pacharine Nirvasesha Sundavari Pashtatari Shatari Dashubha Hare Krishna. Is there any initial questions from that reading? Yes. And they have a microphone. Those online. Thank you. Sacred microphone. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhu. I wanted to ask. The verse explains that Arjuna drove away the rival kings like a lion drives away insignificant animals.
Yes.
How is it possible that one man can drive away an entire army?
Well, he Well, we can. One thing we can conclude that he is not an ordinary warrior. He's a Maharati warrior, which means a Maharati warrior is capable of taking many hundreds of thousands of men. Yeah. Again, the strength of these persons in his previous age is again something inconceivable to us. But I think we can safely conclude that Arjuna was a very great warrior, a very powerful warrior. Yes.
The quiver of Arjuna is inexhaustible. Some limited arrows can come out of it. That's one of the factors.
Yeah. For example, we also had many weapons. Also, actually, it comes later. Actually, he gets the weapons of the devas. But yeah, for instance, we just heard how from burning the Kanda of the forest, he was awarded an inexhaustible quiver. So basically, in answer, he's a very powerful warrior. He's not an ordinary warrior. This is Arjuna, one of the greatest warriors ever to be known. Yes.
Yeah, I was going to add to that as well, because there's a very famous, well-known book called The Art of War. You might have heard of it. It's written by this Chinese guy. And in that book, he talks about how part of the art of war is not even so much about how you attack them, but it's creating almost like a psychology in the opponent that they're already feeling defeated because of the threat of them, what could be the outcome of losing. So they're already kind of compromised in their prowess, kind of thing like that. So there's also a psychology behind, as well as the physical kind of like throwing rocks or whatever, stones and swords, you know. So I'm sure Arjuna had all that at his disposal as well.
You know, just his prowess itself was enough to cause fear in many warriors, just the prowess of Arjuna in of itself. Sometimes they could, with a mantra, they could fire one arrow, but they could put one arrow on the bow and then 10,000 arrows would come out just by mantra. They were such powerful persons that they would, you know, they would do different austerities and they would be gifted these different cities. And just by touching water and then chanting mantra, they could invoke wonderful, amazing weapons. Yes.
I guess one of the things we can also mention is that most important is that he had the full protection of Krishna.
Yeah.
That made him invincible.
Yeah. And it's Krishna by his side. It's okay? Any other questions? Good job, Bhutti.
Thank you. I just wanted to ask, in the dowry, when they gave away thousands of maid servants and thousands of man servants, so isn't it a kind of slavery?
Yes.
Yes? Okay, that's clear. Thank you.
But nice to be a slave in Dwarka.
But
the conditions, obviously the conditions and the treatment, they would be honored. They're honored to go, to be given, and to be going to Dwarka, because basically they go to Dwarka. It's a great honor for them. Mm-hmm. They have different manservants. Many of them are many bands of eunuchs, etc. You read in the Mahabharata about the situation, the social structure. And they were all happy to be engaged in their specific duty, whatever that may be, because the whole atmosphere was saturated with Dharma. So persons were engaged in worship of the Lord in one of his various forms. So they were very much satisfied. And they were satisfied to serve the higher castes. Like the sutras, for instance, were very happy in their occupation. They wasn't burning with envy, trying to, for instance, in the battle of Kurukshetra, there was, as we know, there was hundreds of millions of troops. There was also hundreds of thousands of cooks. There was hundreds of thousands of weapon makers and chariot fixers. There's hundreds of thousands of sutras were there. There was hundreds of thousands of Brahmins there to So we do the rites burning up at night to burn the bodies. Yeah, when the sun went down, then all these Brahmins would come out, and all the Sudras would pile up the bodies and burn the bodies. But they were all very happy in their respective roles, you know, because society was more or less, to a large degree, still based on religious principles. So they were quite happy in their role as being maidservant, quite happy in their role as being a manservant. And there was no doubt, of course, there'd be people like Duryodhan, of course, persons of a more demonic nature, but in general, everyone was engaged in occupational duty. And it was quite strict in one sense, and the Kshatriyas would also make sure that that was the case, that was their specific duty and occupation, to make sure everyone was situated within their vana or ashram, doing their duties correctly. And society was much more well structured, and there was clear distinctions between who was who. So when we hear such a dowry, of course, then we, as you mentioned, we have the modern concept of slavery and all the negativity that goes with it, chains and maltreatment and this and that. But it's not like that at all, it's complete. It isn't like that in any way, shape or form. And, yes?
Regarding Vinapati's question, and the maid servants, do they stay servants their whole life, or they also get married and they have their own, like, do they stay in this position as servants of the bride?
No, they would also have, depends, obviously some would not marry, the eunuchs would not marry, but some would also, they would marry, depending, they would marry other servants, and then some would not, and some would, yeah. Some would and some would not, so it's a society. Some of the servants would also have their own humble little dwelling, their own humble family, okay. Wife and children, and generally they would, generally after the sacrifices, etc., then the there'd be so much wealth is in abundance that it will be given to the Sudras, the fine clothing, lots of jewels and things like that, and they'd be very happy. It's hard to really, one sense, or we can try, but it's hard to picture the scene where in this day and age, hardly anyone is fully satisfied with their specific occupation. Yeah, everyone is enticed to try and obtain bigger or more, because there's a lack of spiritual satisfaction. Persons thinking that satisfaction and the well-being can be found from one's placement in society or what one has materially. So therefore you have some persons maybe doing a job according to their nature, but they may be wrong, and then they watch the television, they see this and they see that, and they're enticed into, or they're kind of, in one sense, they're intimidated into thinking that they are inferior because they're sweeping the street rather than serving, or they're sweeping the street rather than working for the tax office. So you can understand, in material life, persons that with a lack of spiritual knowledge, everyone is envious of the position of someone else, especially if they have a higher occupation. Some persons are quite happy with their specific duty, and they're not so desirous of obtaining someone else's duty. You do find some persons like that, they're quite happy to have a more simpler way of life. So the atmosphere, as in then, as in now, is something completely different. Because of a lack of a spirituality, because of a lack of dharma, then everyone is generally unsatisfied. So therefore we have revolutions, isn't it? We have the communist revolution, this revolution, that revolution. Is one people want to do away with another rulers, and they kill them, and then 200 years later someone else kills them, and everyone's killing everyone, and thousands of persons are envious of other countries and this and that, and there's wars constantly. Yeah. Is that it? Anything else? Such a commanding, my guru.
I just wanted to, Prabhu, you mentioned about the civilization, and I just wondered if that is accessible to us. I mean, the idea of civilization, I get that it's kind of removed from how it will have been at that time, but is civilization, like they asked Mahatma Gandhi, you know, what do you think of Western civilization? It's a good idea, yeah. I mean, is that idea, is it something that is available to us? That actually civilization could be a possibility that we could create? Or is it like it's too late now?
Well, Prabhupada did say, didn't he? He did say that his unfinished work was the establishment of Varna and Ashram. So in our own humble way, we are, as a society of Krishna consciousness, we are trying to, in our own humble way, at least to create communities within the larger community as such. So it's also said that in every town and village, Lord Krishna's name will be chanted. So that's quite intriguing in of itself. So who's to know what the future may hold, like in 5,000 years, in 6,000 years time. It may well be that society is based with Krishna conscious leaders, etc., who are leading the world according to religious principles. But as it stands at the present, at the moment, we are trying in our own humble way to create our own civilization within chaos. We are trying our own farm communities, our own communities as well. We are trying to create a civilization based on principles, based on Vedic principles, in our own humble way. So it's definitely possible by Krishna's grace. But that may be some time, it may be some generations ahead before we see actually countries becoming Krishna conscious. But that's perhaps up to us to make it happen faster. It's up to us to kind of play that role. Anything else on these points? Civilization. So let's just say one point I was thinking to comment upon is this wonderful description showing something of the unlimited opulences of the Supreme Personality Godhead. And we can see very much that Krishna is this, we are parts and parcels of Krishna, and our constitutional position is to take pleasure in what Krishna has, is to feel inclined to assist Krishna in his unlimited pastime, so to speak, is to be in a mood of servitorship to Krishna and not in competition. This is the nature of the material world, that is generally we are in competition of Krishna. We are trying to be Krishna. But here we should see that we have no chance of being Krishna. Yeah. Describe the year, 16,000 wives and so much opulence, 16,000 palaces. Yeah. So this is what it means to be the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And it isn't like that we are the losers if we accept the subordinate position to the Supreme Person. Actually, we are the losers if we try and be in competition with Him. We are the losers. And we lose, and what do we get when we lose? We get the material body subject to birth, disease, old age and death. So we are the losers. So in hearing these wonderful opulences of Krishna, this is the idea. We should see that Krishna should give us, we shouldn't be like Duryodhana when he's hearing of the opulences of the Pandavas. He's becoming envious like anything, as we heard, isn't it? He's burning with envy. Actually, the Rajasuya sacrifice, was amazing in his, in the, it was just, who is in charge of looking after all the gifts that was, that the Pandavas receiving? I think it was Duryodhana, in one sense, because they hadn't, the full energy hadn't exploded at the point of the Rajasuya sacrifice. So Duryodhana were assisting in this great Rajasuya sacrifice. So some of them had the role of accounting, keeping track of all the gifts that were given to the Pandavas. And I think Duryodhana played the part like that. Because of course he was trying to, you know what it's like when materialistic, or when perhaps when someone is envious, the last thing you want to do is to admit you're envious. So it says Duryodhana, the last thing he wants to do is admit he's envious. Okay, so all right, we'll take it for face value. Okay, you can be in charge of all the gifts that come. He's burning with envy already. So, and it's described in the Mahabharata, the amount of wealth that comes for this Rajasuya sacrifice is inconceivable. The amount of wealth that gives given to the Pandavas is inconceivable. It's described that there's a gong playing, and every time there's a certain amount of thousands and thousands of kind of in gold comes, and then there's a gong goes dong. And this gong was going dong, dong. And every time Duryodhana would hear it, he would burn with envy. So then there's Krishna, and then there's Krishna in Dwarka, and he has 16,108 wives, 16,108 palaces, and every, isn't it, with every wife he has how many children? Hundred sons, or something like that. Hundred sons with every one. Mm-hmm. So unlimited, unlimited wealth, unlimited opulence. That's Krishna, that's the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But in this material world, we're so proud of what little we have, isn't it? In this material world, it's said that the pauper is proud of his penny. The pauper has one penny. Well, we're so attached to insignificant things, isn't it? We see even persons who have no home, they're very much attached to their belongings, isn't it? Their bag with their things. The same way we're very, very much attached in this material world to the things that we so-called have, or the things that Krishna has given us. But the idea is that let's worship Krishna. Krishna has everything. Krishna has unlimited opulences. Krishna is the supreme enjoyer. And again, we do not lose out. We are only to gain. Because we are part and parcels of Krishna, we are created in that specific way to assist Krishna in his unlimited opulence and pastimes. And that will make us happy. That's our constitutional position. Hare Krishna. Any questions or comments? Okay, so we have some results in Govinda's pure vegetarian restaurant. We served a total of 211 customers and collected 1,735.06 lecture points. And in Radha's boutique, we distributed 3 books and collected 191 lecture points. And on book distribution, we have 2 devotees going up. Beginning with Bhakta Rajesh, who collected 14 lakshmi points, distributed 5 meaning books for 2.5 lakh points. And on top of the list, Bhakta Dia, 23 lakshmi points, distributed 2 meaning books, 10 mahabhu books for 21 lakh points. That's the first of 2 devotees collecting 40 27 lakshmi points and distributing 7 medium books, 10 maha big books for 23.5 book points. Before we read our prayer, we'll ask for some servers on the lady side. So on the men's side, anyone to help serve Prashad? 1, 2, 3, 4, and to clean the temple after Prashad? 1, 2. Okay, so before we bring up Prashad, let's read our prayer together. Dear Sri Sri Radha Vandanishwar, Jagannath Baladev Subhadra, Sri Sri Gauranitai, and Giri Govardhan, we offer our most respectful obeisances unto you. With a mood of deep gratitude and appreciation, we request your causeless mercy upon us. For your pleasure, if you so desire, we wish to erect a holy place of your transcendental pastimes that will attract unlimited souls to your service and fulfill the vision of your pure devotee Srila Prabhupada for London. Please enable us to cooperate together in order to satisfy you in this way. We, your surrendered servants, humbly beg. Okay, so now we bring up Prashad, continue our day's duties and serving the Lord. Thank you.